Hey, how's it going? It's been a little while since the last review, and that's mostly just because I spent the longest time trying to figure out how I would approach this review. Seriously, reviewing a TV or streaming service is not the same as reviewing a game, and I spent significantly more time playing games than watching shows. Basically, I had no idea what I wanted to do from a writing or even editing perspective for this thing, so what you're seeing is the closest I'll get to a version of it I'm satisfied with. At the same time, it's my first review tackling something like this, so if I ever decide to review anything that isn't a video game again, there will be some lessons learned by then. Hopefully. Anyway, enough production preamble. It's finally time to talk about Sonic Prime 3 months after it ended. Yes, I'm late again, but it's a running thing with this channel, so stick around and I hope you enjoy. Okay, so, where to begin? Well, as I'm sure you all know by now, Sonic has had a handful of animated series in the past that range from pretty great to... What the fuck was this? Why did they do this? I mean, if nothing else, each of these series are distinct and have their own appeal. With the most recent show being Sonic Boom, an actually pretty quality comedy show, at least from a writing perspective, based on a failed side franchise experiment, it's safe to say that fans are excited to see where Sonic would go next on the small screen. This takes us to late 2020, when Netflix accidentally spilled the beans on a new animated Sonic show by Wild Brain and Man of Action, with the latter being responsible for such classics as Ben 10 and Generator X. The former, Johnny Test and Mega Man powered up are not exactly the most impressive things to have on your resume. Regardless, excitement would build up over the course of the next 2 years despite the absolutely awful marketing cycle this thing saw. We have to talk about this. So after that initial blunder from Netflix, the next time we would hear of Sonic Prime was through these concept art leaks that gave us a snippet of what the show was all about. It looks like a show that placed Sonic in a post-apocalyptic future ruled by Eggman, which pretty immediately drew comparisons to the 90s Sonic Sat AM and Sonic Forces. Well, at least in terms of the premise. Then, fast forward to the Sonic Central, where they dedicated like 2 minutes to showing us an Eggman logo that meant absolutely nothing, and a plot synopsis that we had already heard by that point. This would be the last news we would get of the show for a whole ass year. Seriously. The Sonic Central happened in June 2021, and we didn't even get our first actual trailer for the damn thing until May of 2022. This was just a short trailer that just gave us a small animation of Sonic, who was now being voiced by Devin Mack. Get used to that though, because every trailer for this show was like this. You get a clip that's 30 seconds or less just telling you, hey, this character's in the show, isn't that so cool? I seriously don't know what they were thinking with that. Now it's November 2022. Sonic Frontiers just dropped and the people are loving it. We finally get an actual full trailer for Prime and it looks like it's gonna be pretty awesome. Another month passes and they drop the first 8 episodes out of the initial 24 they had slated for us. Keep that number in mind, by the way, it's gonna be important later, trust me. I'm gonna call this problem number one. Netflix has this binge it all now and forget about it in a month model to their show releases that can pretty often kill the hype you'd otherwise get by dropping episodes weekly. As a JoJo fan, you have to believe I understand that pain. It will become very apparent to you when you finish the first batch of episodes that this show was probably intended as a weekly drop, but we'll go more into detail about this later. Also, I'm calling them batches and not seasons because it's just a cheap trick Netflix uses for marketing. Cool? Cool. I guess now is probably a good time to mention that you could actually watch the first episode a little bit early. On Roblox. Oh god, now I've got to go on a tangent again. Here we go. So, also in 2022, they dropped an officially licensed Roblox Sonic game by the name of Sonic Speed Simulator, where you run around grinding levels and racing other players. And in typical Roblox fashion, this thing was stuffed with predatory microtransactions designed to make kids steal their parents' credit cards. It was pretty fun though. Controls surprisingly well, looks great considering the platform it was made for, and had very addictive gameplay. They would also hold various events for Sonic releases around the time, such as Origins and Frontiers. For Prime, however, you actually got to watch the entire first episode in incredibly shitty quality. Now, you're probably wondering who would even want to do that. Me. I did. Of course, I watched it again when all the episodes dropped so I could count more than 10 pixels on the screen. So, with all that build up out of the way, was Sonic Prime good? Let's get to it! The first episode is called Shattered and is a 45-minute epic that sets the stage for everything to come. The show starts out with a classic battle against Dr. Eggman as he attempts to take an artifact of immense power. Nothing out of the ordinary from the game so far. The artifact is known as the Paradox Prism, and Eggman wants to use its power to recreate the world in his image, so Sonic and friends go to stop him. Right off the bat, the show makes it a point to let you know that this is a Sonic who's a little less mature than his game counterpart. He jumps into action without listening to his friends quite a lot, which eventually leads to him shattering the Paradox Prism. This sets up his character arc for the show, and believe me, they really want that arc to be as obvious as possible to you. No subtlety here. Oh, and Shadow's here and he fights Sonic for a bit. Honestly, I could say that about pretty much all his appearances throughout the show, but he'll get more plot relevance later. Kinda. To get back to the main shenanigans, the shattering of the Paradox Prism causes Sonic to be flung through space and the world split into multiple different realities where his friends are completely different people. These are called Shatterspaces, and the first one Sonic is thrown into is New York City, a world where Green Hill has been turned into a mechanical dystopia ruled by Eggman. Well, in this case, Eggmen. They're known as the Chaos Council, and let's just get it out of the way so I don't have to talk about them again. These guys just flat out suck. They're easily the main thing about this show that just completely takes me out of it, because I'm supposed to believe that this group of incompetent fucks, consisting of a geriatric guy, some bum-ass teenager, a hipster obsessed with yoga, and that fucking baby, took over the world? Really? The only one that's somewhat bearable to watch is Mr. Dr. Eggman, I shit you not, that is his name, and that's because he's literally just regular old Eggman with a toupee. At that point, it's like, why even have the others there? Couldn't it have just been him? And I get that the angle they were maybe going for was that the Shatterspace variants of the characters are meant to represent different fragmented aspects of their personalities, and that does apply here. Dr. Babble represents the temper tantrums he has when losing to Sonic. Dr. Don't represents his tech-savvy side. Dr. Deep represents his intellect, I guess? And Dr. Dunnett represents his old-fashioned views or something, I really don't know with this one. Mr. Dr. Eggman seems to represent his pride. Cool. Only one problem. These five chuckle fucks all come from the same reality! I get more and more upset the longer I have to think about these guys, let alone having to remember what they were even fucking called. Let's just talk about something the show does good. First up, the voice performances. Devin Mack does a great job slipping into the role of Sonic, having a similar vibe to Roger Craig Smith's Sonic, but a little more youthful and energetic. I think it works for the version of Sonic the show presents us with. It's also pretty great we finally got another black actor voicing Sonic in a cartoon after 30 years. Ashley Ball makes for a unique Tails, not really all that similar to any version of him from the games. I like whenever they go for a more nasally sounding Tails, which she absolutely pulls off here. Knuckles has two voice actors, Vincent Tong and Adam Nerada, who bring their respective Knuckles variants to life. I liked Vincent's New Yorker accent for Renegade Knuckles quite a lot, it just feels right for him. Amy is voiced by Shannon Chan Kent. She's pretty okay for the most part, but her performance as Rusty Rose was definitely one of the most memorable out of the entire show's cast. Rouge's voice actress is Kazumi Evans, who mostly does the same voice for each of her variants, but that's because they're hardly all that different from one another. Either way, she brings just the right energy to the character. Then there's Shadow, as portrayed by Ian Hanlon. Now, I'll never outright say they should replace voice actors, because believe it or not, people losing their jobs is not cool. But I would be so down to see him take the reins of Shadow in the games at some point, because he's incredible here. It just sucks he doesn't get all that much screen time to work with, but what's there is absolutely gold. Lastly, there's Brian Drummond, who is actually making his second appearance in a Sonic show. That's right, he was actually the voice of Knuckles in Sonic Underground, I promise this will be the last time I bring that show up, and is now back to voice Dr. Eggman. He's no Mike Pollock, but that's because only Mike Pollock can be Mike Pollock, but has just the right amount of menace and goofiness you'd want in an Eggman portrayal. Oh, and just to add these in here, Orbot and Q-Bot are both voiced by Devin Mack as well, but have a total of three dialogue lines in the whole show. Big and all his variants are voiced by Ian Hanlon, and it's fine. Certainly a Big the Cat voice. Now it gets weird again though, because there are a certain number of random extras in the show that look like Sonic Forces OCs that have speaking roles. Two of them in particular are this pirate guy voiced by Jacksepticeye, yes, that Jacksepticeye, and the squad commander voiced by Valkyrie the streamer person who I'd never heard of before this. Not throwing shade, I just genuinely didn't know who she was, but she seems cool enough, and both of these guys fit their roles well. It's just weird they picked influencers that have nothing to do with Sonic to voice the Sonic show. They should call me up, I'd be totally down to do a background character. You know, just saying. Please answer my calls. So yeah, that covers the cast. Great lineup overall, and I hope to see these guys in some future projects, whether it's another actual season of Prime or something else entirely. Another aspect of the show I just have to praise is the visuals. The show has a very appealing 3D art style with some nice texture work and lighting that really bring the characters to life. The animation is absolutely gorgeous and takes full advantage of the cartoony designs of Sonic and the cast with plenty of exaggeration and squash and stretch. Every movement is made to look as fluid and eye-catching as possible, which leads to some of the most electrifying fight sequences you'll ever see from a Sonic project. Seriously, every one of these was an absolute treat to watch, and even some of the slower, more dialogue-heavy moments had some great animation work done on them. The techniques used here make for the best-looking Sonic show to date. When it comes to the locations, they're pretty hit or miss. New York is pretty nicely realized with a good variety of locations, including the streets, rooftops, subway, resistance base, and Chaos Council HQ all having plenty of love put into them. The same can't be said for some of the other Shatter Spaces. The second one Sonic visits is the Boss Cage Maze, which is mostly just trees. It's pretty boring aesthetically, but the thick of the jungle at least varies things up a little bit more. No places where things start to get a little dry, ironically enough. It's just a world completely covered in water with only a couple of islands to speak of. Nothing visually interesting is going on here. Then there's the Grim, which is true to its name because it's pretty grim how goddamn barren it is. Although in this case, that's not such a bad thing because that is kind of the point. Then of course you have the main location, Green Hill. This kind of transitions onto my next point to do with the overall plot and world building, of which the latter needed a lot of work. The main thing that bothers me here is that Green Hill is referred to as if that's just the entire world. Whenever anyone mentions getting Sonic back to his reality, it's always referred to only as Green Hill, which kind of sucks because it would have been nice to see some other iconic locations transformed by the prison being shattered. On top of that, the way they tried to market this show to fans was by saying it was canon to the main series. We'll talk about this more later, believe me, but what I will say now is that, first of all, you're trying to market to people who would just watch it anyway. Sonic fans were going to watch this show regardless of whether it was canon or not, so this was pretty pointless. It also means that it makes even less sense for them to just call that whole reality Green Hill. Admittedly, that is a bit of a nitpick, so I'll move off that topic and talk more about the actual show. So, the first set of episodes revolves around Sonic trying to escape from New York, where he first learns that he basically messed everything up because no one is their true self. At least, the way Sonic knew them. This leads to some conflict, mainly with 9, the edgier and more secluded counterpart to Tails. Eventually, Sonic is able to gain his trust and works together with the rebels to attempt an overthrow of the Chaos Council. Sonic tracks down the first shard and is teleported to the next world when making contact with it. Very promising start to the show with some nice dialogue and great action sequences. We immediately follow that up with a very repetitive couple episodes in the jungle, where Sonic has to learn for a second time that its inhabitants aren't his real friends. Okay, that's getting a little bit redundant, but I can bear with it. What I can't bear is that you're essentially forced to sit through 45 minutes of Sonic trying to convince Thorn Rose that she can trust him and settle the beef between her and the scavengers above. Not the most interesting stuff, but at least has a pretty nice ending where they all make up and Sonic is sent back to New York. This will become a theme. All the rebels basically feel betrayed because for them, weeks have passed since he was last there, despite only being a few hours for him. Time moving differently in each of the Shatterspaces pretty much never comes up again after this, by the way. Eventually, 9 shows back up and takes Sonic to the Grim, where he explains his plan to make it into a utopia, free from the suffering he endured back in New York. Sonic helps the rebels again, more fights ensue, and it's off to the next world. Once in No Place, he meets Knuckles the Dread, who wants to find some treasure because YARR, he be a pirate! Or something along those lines. Anyway, to absolutely no one's surprise, he tries to double-cross Sonic and take the prize all for himself. After an attack from Rusty Rose and the Chaos Council, Sonic is teleported again, but this time into the void where he's confronted by none other than Shadow. This is where the second batch begins, with probably my favourite episode in the whole show. Up to this point, Sonic has kinda acted like a bit of an idiot, so having Shadow show up to literally kick some sense into him was a breath of fresh air. Shadow also happens to be the best character in the show because he's just not having it with any of this bullshit, and as I got closer to the end of the series, I found that more and more relatable. Anyway, we learn that Shadow can't enter any of the Shatter Spaces and that he didn't get all split up because he used Chaos Control right at the point of impact. What this unfortunately means is that Shadow gets sidelined for a good majority of the show. Well, that sucks. It's also revealed here that there's another Shatter Space they appropriately named Ghost Hill, which is basically just a hollow version of the base, or Prime, world. Holy shit, now the title actually makes sense! The next few episodes are actually fairly exciting, being a race to defeat the Chaos Council throughout the previous worlds we visited. They captured 9 near the end of Batch 1 and are using him to help locate the shards, but each member of the Chaos Council has a different idea of what to do with the power once they obtain them all. Predictably, this causes an argument that will no doubt lead to their undoing later on. Near the end, we get introduced to Chaos Sonic, who's basically this show's version of Metal Sonic. Also, Sonic comments on this as if he's never had a robot copy made of him before, and did I mention that this show is supposedly canon? Alright, I'm gonna try not to bring that up anymore, but it's just so stupid. Chaos Sonic is actually a lot of fun though. It's a nice change of pace from the metals and mechas we're used to. He wasn't designed to be a silent killer, but rather to break Sonic's mind and then body. He's also by far the most annoying character, but this is by design, so he wraps back around to actually being very likable in my opinion. His design is also pretty sick. I really like how he uses the screen face to emote. It just gives him a ton of personality. This is also where they start to establish the Sisterhood of Amy, consisting of Thorn Rose, Black Rose, and Rusty Rose, who had a heel turn back in No Place. This was one of quite a few character arcs that took place over the course of the show, and it was arguably the most engaging out of all of them. Rusty Rose was definitely one of my favourite characters, being this initially cold and unfeeling jobber, a far cry from her Prime World counterpart. Her finding kinship with the other Amys was just really fun and wholesome to watch. I kinda wish there was more of that in the show. It really feels like the different versions of the characters interact with each other beyond just a confused glance. As this set of episodes wrap up, the fights get pretty intense, but Sonic is able to recover all of the shards aside from 1. He heads to Ghost Hill with Shadow and 9, where they're attacked by the Chaos Council. Sonic and Shadow work together to take the council down in yet another incredible action sequence, but it's not enough. Nine imbues Sonic with more prismatic energy, leading to the coldest moment of the entire show. He gets this new form, which I'll just call Prismatic Sonic, and takes out the council for good. Except not really, because they take the gloves off and create an Eggman Kaiju out of prism energy. Sonic powers up even more and is now able to fight using multiple apparitions of himself. I'm just gonna call this form Shatter Sonic since, you know, there's multiple of him. He takes down the Titan Frontier style and the day is saved. Except not really, again. Because remember how I said Sonic got all the shards aside from one? Well, that's because the final one is on the Grim, the world that Nine has been trying to make inhabitable all this time. Not wanting Sonic to take things back to how they were and create a new world instead, he takes the shards and betrays him. Despite the fact that this was also a pretty predictable twist, I feel it was handled really well and could lead to some very interesting scenarios as we head into Batch 3. Batch 2 actually ended up being my favourite. I feel like it had the best action scenes, featured the worlds colliding a lot more, and had some great character interactions I feel were missing in Batch 1. It also started and ended with my two favourite episodes in the entire show, so that probably helps. So, heading into the final 8 episodes, wait, what do you mean there's only 7? All the press releases said there were 24 episodes. Batch 1 had 8. Batch 2 also had 8, which is 16. Add the 7 from this batch and we're one short. Did they lie to us? Well, it's more complicated than a simple yes or no. You see, the first episode of the show was 45 minutes, twice as long as the standard 22 minute episodes. For that reason, they count it as 2 episodes, which makes absolutely no goddamn sense. I can't think of any other show that did this, but correct me if I'm wrong. Still, I can't help but feel a little slighted by this. Is what I would be saying if I feel like we needed that extra episode. In fact, the 7 that we got is way too much. It's time to talk about that, isn't it? So, carrying on from Batch 2's cliffhanger, Sonic and Shadow go to confront Nine at the Grim. Practically the entire remainder of the show takes place in this extremely barren location, and it doesn't help that they brought back the repetitiveness of Batch 1 and increased it 1,000-fold. Seriously. Let me tell you exactly the format of these final few episodes. Sonic tries to reason with Nine as if he's the Tails he knew. This predictably doesn't work. Nine sends out robot copies of Sonic and his friends to attack. Sonic, with some assistance from the rest of the cast, dispatches them. He tries to reason with Nine again, only for the Fox to send out more goons. Rinse. And. Repeat. This could have easily been 3 episodes. 4 at a stretch. As great and spectacularly animated as the fights are, it starts to wear thin by the time you get to the 5th fight out of like 20 or more, and that's not even an exaggeration. There are give or take 3 fights per episode. To me, this just reads like they didn't plan for this thing to be a 23 episode series, and had to do some insane padding. And yeah, it comes as no surprise that this is by far my least favourite batch of the show. I don't even need to get into the plot here because I basically just did. That's how repetitive it is. The only thing of note to mention is that they take out Shadow for like 4 episodes again and explain that he was stuck in a pit fighting a bunch of Sonic bots. A pit that he just spin dashes out of with Sonic with minimal effort, like what? Whatever. Sonic is eventually able to talk Nine down from his villain arc, but in another predictable turn of events, the Chaos Council was just using Sonic and the gang to get all the shards in place. The Council gets on each other's throats again about what they'll do with the prism's power, which leads to them getting destroyed pretty quickly. But, in order to restore the prism to its full power, they need to drain some of Sonic's prismatic energy, which causes him to go ghost on us. With a pretty limited amount of time, Shadow, with the help of all our multiversal friends, gets Sonic back to Green Hill. This time, things will go differently. Sonic learns from his mistakes and actually listens to his friends this time, helping them fight in a way that will prevent another Shatter event from taking place. It's genuinely a great scene and almost makes that fucking gauntlet you just had to put up with to get here worth it. Almost. So yeah, Shadow teleports the prism away using Chaos Control and the day is saved. Very meme-worthy close-up of Sonic and roll credits. So that was Sonic Prime, a show I actually enjoyed quite a lot for the first two batches that was unfortunately let down by an awful final run of episodes. That, and just in general, it's one of those things where if I actually turn my brain on and think about it, there are some holes, man. Dropped plot lines, inconsistencies, at times spotty character writing and repetition plague this show, especially in Batch 3. But at the same time, it's a show that was clearly made with a lot of heart and tons of effort was clearly put into making this one of the most appealingly animated portrayals of the Blue Blur to date. The moments that hit with this show really hit, so it makes it just a little more frustrating when it doesn't live up to the standard it sets for itself. I can only hope this show sees a revised version down the line or a director's cut that cleans up some of the more egregious issues. That, or have a season 2 that maybe actually focuses on that Prime world we saw so little of. If there's one thing I really wish we did get more of, it was Sonic's world and friends. The one we know from the games. I really would love to see their dynamic fleshed out and the introduction of other fan favorite characters like Blaze, Silver, or the Chaotix. With that in mind, I also just want to talk about something I've consistently brought up one last time. This show is not canon. They were just using the term as marketing fluff to get an audience of people who were going to watch anyway interested. Watch this show as if it's a separate thing from the games and you'll have a lot more fun. You also won't have to give yourself a headache thinking about where it goes in the timeline because there is absolutely zero consistency with the games here. In conclusion, Sonic Prime is an extremely fun watch with some great spectacle, but a slight lack of substance and a ton of repetitiveness. A great show to just turn your brain off and have a swell time. Okay, that ended up being way longer than I thought it would. Turns out my feelings on this show were a lot more complicated than I thought. I apologize if certain parts of this came out really negative. I actually did enjoy the show a lot, but the ending really soured things quite a bit. But as always, I encourage you to watch the show and come to your own conclusions. If you did already, how did you like it? Good? Great? Meh? Worst Sonic show ever? Let me know below, I'd love to talk about it. If you enjoyed my insane ramblings, then go ahead and hit that epic subscribe button and turn on post notifications so you're always in the loop. Follow me on Twitch if you want to see some livestream BS, it's always a good time. And follow me on Twitter if you want to keep up with my thoughts on stuff. It would be nice to have some real human interaction on there for a change. Alright, that's enough from me for now. There's a certain game starring a particular princess that I want to talk about next time, so stay tuned for that. Have a great rest of your day, night, or whenever you're watching this, and I'll talk to you next time.